Okay, hello everyone. And my name is Simon Plummer, and I would like to thank Ingenuity for inviting my company, microMatrices, to present to you today. microMatrices is a specialist provider of mechanism-based risk assessment services to the pharmaceutical and chemical industries. We provide services for integrating genomics and epigenomics analysis with more conventional toxicity endpoints to investigate mechanisms of toxicity using a unique combination of in-house and commercial software. We do this analysis to characterize previously identified toxicities in greater detail and also for retrospective analysis of as yet uncharacterized toxicities. And these sorts of studies are useful for product development and also for product rescue. My webinar today is divided in two parts. Firstly, I'm going to discuss how work utilizing integrated microRNA and messenger RNA profiling in the context of some novel mouse models has provided new insights into the mechanism of non-genotoxic carcinogenesis. Secondly, I will describe how this insight could lead to the identification of potential biomarkers that may be useful in classifying carcinogens in the NGC class according to their mode of action. So the work I will describe is conducted partly at CSR Biosciences and was performed under the auspices of the MarCAR project funded by the Innovative Medicines Initiative. There are two fundamental mechanisms whereby chemicals can cause cancer. A chemical can either directly cause DNA damage, or it can increase the rate of spontaneous DNA mutations. The first mechanism is characteristic of so-called genotoxic carcinogens. And chemicals in this class can be detected relatively easily with short-term tests. However, the second mechanism is more difficult to detect. Chemicals that act via this mechanism have been termed non-genotoxic carcinogens. And the regulatory test currently used to detect these chemicals is an expensive and time-consuming two-year bioassay. Hence, identification of non-genotoxic carcinogens is an important challenge for the drug and chemical industries. There are currently no accurate short-term tests for NGC compounds. Hence, there is a need for biomarkers that can predict this activity. One way to identify biomarkers that could predict NGC activity is by developing a greater understanding of the molecular mechanisms of NGC effects relevant to the process of carcinogenesis, and to use this information to develop mode of action classifiers to categorize chemicals in this class. Nuclear hormone receptors have been implicated in regulating the response of rodent liver to NGC compounds. For example, constitutive androstenedione receptor, CAR, is thought to mediate procarcinogenic responses to the prototypical NGC phenobarbital. One of the characteristics of this response is hyperplasia, associated with an increased cell proliferation in the liver. But little is known about the genes that coordinate this response. We have used gene expression and microRNA analysis in the context of some novel transgenic mouse strains to identify pathways that may be important in the cell proliferation response to phenobarbital. Try to understand how CAR mediates changes to the expression of genes involved in these pathways. So the samples we analyzed were derived from a recently published study by Roth et al. And the study utilized a CXR transadmet mouse strain. And to generate these strains, recombinant DNA technologies have been used to make mice that are constitutively either not out or humanized for both the CAR and CXR receptors.
The ROS study demonstrated that the proliferative response to phenobarb in the liver of these animals following four daily intraperitoneal doses of 80 milligrams per kilogram phenobarbital was CAR-TXR dependent in that it did not occur in the knockout animals and could only be supported with this regime of phenobarb treatment by the mouse and not the human CAR and TXR receptors. I should point out that this dose of phenobarbital when given chronically over a long period induces liver tumors. In our microarray study, we extracted total RNA from the same control and phenobarb-treated wild-type, knockout, and humanized mouse livers, and subjected these samples to messenger RNA and microRNA profiling using adjuvant arrays. We undertook a number of statistical and bioinformatic procedures to analyze and integrate the two types of microarray data. Firstly, in order to identify pathways that were affected by phenobarbital treatment, we performed ANOVA analysis on the expression data. And this process identified phenobarbital treatment-induced differentially expressed genes that were most variable in their response across the genotype. As the phenotypic response to phenobarbital at the level of cell proliferation in the ROS study indicated that only the wild-type mice underwent self-liberation in response to this treatment regime, we postulated that this gene list may contain genes involved in self-liberation, and this idea was tested using Ingenuity pathways analysis. Next, we identified microRNAs and messenger RNAs that were altered by phenobarbital treatment using Resolver software, and we used Gene Spring software to integrate the microRNA and messenger RNA expression data using target scans. This enabled us ultimately to identify microRNA genes potentially involved in the phenobarbital mediated self-liberation response in wild-type mice. And finally, we've used IPA analysis of the functions of genes altered by phenobarbital treatment and targeted by microRNA to filter the profiling data to view with a view to identifying biomarkers that may be useful for classifying NGC compounds. Well, as only the wild-type mice undergo self-proliferation in response to phenobarbital, we postulated that the ANOVA list may contain bias towards genes involved in self-proliferation. And this idea was tested using IPA. And as predicted, we identified overrepresentation of genes in cell proliferation pathways in this ANOVA list. There were two pathways relevant to cell proliferation, namely mitotic roles of polo-like kinase and cell cycle G2M damage checkpoint regulation that were overrepresented, and these are highlighted with the red arrow. We postulated that since only the wild-type mice underwent cell proliferation in response to phenobarb, that these cell proliferation pathways would only be altered in wild-type mice. We tested this hypothesis by overlaying a list of genes significantly altered by phenobarbital in the different mouse strains onto the pathway diagrams using our IPA Path Explore. And by doing this, we confirmed that genes in the polo-like kinase pathway shown here were only affected in the wild-type mice. Now, it was notable that all the genes significantly altered by phenobarb in these mice were upregulated, and this is shown by a red coloration of the nodes in this pathway. And this is consistent with a self-proliferation response to phenobarb occurring uniquely in the wild-type animals. Hence, our profiling data corroborated previously obtained cell proliferation data. Now, it was notable that genes in other pathways that were overrepresented in the ANOVA list were not found to be uniquely altered in the wild-type mice. For example, cytochrome P450s in the 2B and 2C classes were induced in the humanized as well as the wild-type mice. And this was indicative of a functional human receptor in the context of the mouse strain that was humanized with this receptor. Next, we wanted to find a way of integrating the expression array and the microRNA data. And we developed a rationale for this based on the knowledge that microRNAs regulate gene expression in part by targeting messenger RNAs for degradation via the proteasome. We thought that as genes in cell proliferation pathways were upregulated, we might more efficiently identify differentially expressed microRNAs that targeted these genes if we focused on downregulated microRNAs. We used gene spring software to identify differentially expressed genes that were targeted by the downregulated microRNAs using target scans. This algorithm looks for homology between the microRNA and 3' UTR candidate gene. And by doing this, we identified all known genes that could be targeted by the downregulated microRNAs by matching them to all the genes on the array. And there are about 9,500 possible genes that are targeted in this way, which is a pretty daunting number of genes. And next, we used Venn diagram analysis to identify downregulated microRNAs matched to the phenobarbital-induced differentially expressed genes initially here in the wild-type animal. And this identified a much smaller number of genes, 62 genes, that are targeted by downregulated microRNAs and also significantly altered at the messenger RNA level. And this list was exported so that the candidate genes potentially involved in the phenobarbital response could be identified and analyzed. We also repeated this analysis in the knockout animal, and here we identified 31 genes differentially expressed in the knockout mouse in response to phenobarb, which were again targeted by down-regulated microRNA. There were 127 genes targeted by down-regulated microRNAs and differentially expressed in the humanized animal. So we wanted to check whether there was any commonality in the genes targeted by downregulated microRNAs that were altered by phenobarb in the three genotypes. And Venn analysis of the three lists showed that there were very few common genes that were commonly targeted by microRNAs across the three genotypes. Well, since only the wild-type mice underwent cell proliferation, we postulated that the list of genes unique to the wild-type mice might contain genes involved in cell proliferation. Well, this was tested by examining the ontology of genes in the three microRNA-targeted lists, in this case using OntoExpress. We observed that a significant percentage of the upregulated genes targeted by downregulated microRNAs in the wild type, shown in the top left of this slide, were involved in cell proliferation function. However, the list of differentially expressed genes targeted by downregulated microRNAs in the humanized and knockout animals did not contain genes associated with cell proliferation. Hence, this again correlated with the observation that only the wild-type mice undergo cell proliferation in response to this phenobarbital treatment regime. And this led to the idea that microRNAs may be targeting cell proliferation genes in the wild-type animals. And we tested this by using Ingenuity pathways analysis to examine the functions of genes targeted by downregulated microRNAs in the wild-type list. And we found that around 30% of the genes, which in this slide are highlighted in red, were targeted by down-regulated microRNAs, and they were involved in functions associated with cell proliferation. And all of these genes were upregulated. Now, it's highly improbable that such a high percentage of genes altered by phenobarbital treatment and targeted uniquely by down-regulated microRNAs in the wild type should be involved in cell proliferation just by chance. Hence, we postulate that microRNAs could orchestrate a CAR-PXR-mediated cell proliferation response to phenobarbital in the wild-type mouse liver. just to summarize the results that I've just described, we've used ANOVA analysis and IPA analysis of expression, data from phenobarbital treated wild type, knockout, and humanized RPXR mice, and identified a battery of genes involved in self-liberation pathways, which were only altered in the wild type mice. And this correlated with phenotypic observations that only wild type mice show self-liberation as measured by bromodeoxyuridine statement in response to phenobarb. By integrating expression analysis with microRNA profiling analysis, we found that a significant proportion of genes targeted by downregulated microRNAs altered uniquely in the wild type mice were involved in self-liberation, suggesting that microRNAs may orchestrate a self-liberation response in wild type mice. Well, as an important goal for this research was to utilize integrated genomics and epigenomics analysis to identify biomarkers for non-genotoxic carcinogens, we wanted to find a way of testing whether genes or microRNAs identified in this study might be useful as biomarkers. And we became interested in two isoforms of ribonuclease reductase, RRM1 and RRM2. This interest was sparked firstly by our finding that ribonuclease reductase 2 was selectively upregulated by phenobarb in the wild type, and it was targeted by a downregulated microRNA, LEP7C, that had previously been found to have a role in non-genotoxic carcinogenesis induced by peroxisome proliferase receptor agonists. Secondly, in another study, we performed methylation microRNA analysis in the same sample and identified ribonuclease reductase 1 as being selectively hypermethylated as a result of phenobarbital treatment in wild type, but not knockout. I don't have time to discuss this work at this level in this presentation, but this indicated to us that both subunits of this enzyme, which is rate limiting for DNA synthesis, were being targeted selectively in wild-type mice by two different epigenetic mechanisms in response to phenobarbital treatment. So we decided to follow this up and see whether these genes might be useful biomarkers for NGC. But to do this, we examined the expression of ribonuclease reductase 1 and 2 in rat liver samples taken from a study performed by Heidrun Ellinger-Siegelbauer at Bayer. Heidrun had previously generated affymetrix expression array data in rat liver treated with a range of genotoxic, non-genotoxic, and non-carcinogenic compounds. And this study was published recently in Mutation Research. So in collaboration with Heidrun, we investigated the expression of ribonuclease reductase 1 and 2 in the rat liver sample by re-examining this microarray data from this study. We found that the RRMs were selectively upregulated by the NGC compounds, which are highlighted here in orange, but not affected by the genotoxic carcinogen, highlighted in green, or the non-carcinogenic compounds, which are highlighted in purple. However, there was one odd man out, methylenedialin, or MDA. And this compound is classified as a genotoxic carcinogen by virtue of a positive result in the Ames test. And because this was inconsistent with the observation that we had here with the other genotoxic compounds, we decided to follow this up by looking at the expression profile of MDA a bit more closely. We investigated expression profiles of MDA compared to the other treatments against some carcinogenesis relevant pathways. And this analysis again was performed by Heidrun Ellinger-Siegelbauer at Bayer. So the heat maps are made by ordering genes vertically within carcinogenesis relevant pathways by 1D clustering and horizontally according to the treatment time point. Well, unlike other genotoxic carcinogens, which are shown on the left of the top panel, MDA does not show a characteristic upregulation of genes involved in DNA damage and oxidative stress. If you look at this panel, you can see that a lot of the genes that fall into this pathway are highlighted in red, indicating that they've been upregulated. Hence, we found that MDA was not showing a showing a profile more like that of the non-genotoxic carcinogen, which is shown towards the right hand, right middle of this upper panel. We also looked at cell survival pathways, and again, in relation to the cell survival pathways, MDA showed a profile more like that observed for the non-genotoxic carcinogen. You can see this in the lower panel. We also examined cell proliferation pathways by looking at genes involved in cell cycle progression. And NGCs, classical compounds in this class, such as Wyeth and phenobarb, show an early upregulation of cell cycle progression genes indicative of a direct proliferative response. You can see in the case of Wyeth, there's a very early upregulation of genes involved in cell cycle progression at the earlier time points, which is towards the left-hand side of the Wyeth panel. MDA also caused an early upregulation of genes involved in cell cycle progression, similar to the other NGC compounds. You can see indication of upregulation occurring at the three-day time point in a number of these genes with methylene dialysis. So to summarize the results, upregulation of ribonuclease reductase correlated with the NGC classification of a number of NGC compounds in a Bayer rat study. However, there was one odd man out, methylene dianylate, and this compound was previously classified as a genotoxic carcinogen on the basis of a positive Ames test. However, when we examined gene expression profiles of this compound, we found it does not induce a characteristic DNA damage or cell proliferation response to that seen with genotoxic carcinogen. In fact, methylene dianylin showed a pattern of deregulation of cell cycle progression genes more like the NGC than the GC compound. And this raises the question as to whether MDA is really a genotoxic or a non-genotoxic carcinogen in rat liver in this model. And cast doubt, I think, on whether or not the genotoxic classification is correct for rat liver. So to conclude, the use of transgenic mouse strains and pathways analysis as tools as biological filters of genomic data is useful in the identification of genes involved in the cell proliferation response to phenobarbital. Integration of messenger RNA and microRNA data in the context of these mouse models provides new insights into potential mechanisms of non-genotoxic carcinogenesis, in particular indicating that microRNA may orchestrate a phenobarbital-induced cell proliferation response via CAR and PXR in the wild-type mice. These insights into mechanisms of non-genotoxic carcinogenesis have the potential to yield biomarkers for this response. And in this regard, the ribonuclease reductase genes, or perhaps microRNAs that regulate them, have shown potential as mode of action classifiers for this type of compound in rodents. So at that point, I'm going to finish my presentation. I'd like to acknowledge everybody involved in this work. People at PXR Biosciences, Novartis, Agilent, University of Dundee, Bayer, and last but not least, the Innovative Medicines Initiative, who partly funded this work under the auspices of the MARCAR program. I thank you very much for your attention, and I'd be very happy to address any questions that you may have on my presentation.